Well, thank you, ma'am. It's a pleasure to be here indeed. You know, although ma'am talked about my robotics activities and Abhyas project, today I am here on a different mission altogether. We are talking about nanotechnology and how you do nanosensing. So our lab basically caters to a various variety of requirements related to fabrication of stand-up nanostructures, particularly one-dimensional nanostructures. And we apply these to various areas like gas sensing is one of them. You know, we also want to do some remediation, particularly water remediation. There are projects which are running between effluent treatment plants at Jodhpur to remediate, to photocatalyze, to take off dyes. And there is a huge application that these one-dimensional nanostructures find quite a bit of utility. So today's topic is different than robotics, okay? And I call it the fabrication, characterization, and application of various nanostructures in sensing and in remediation. So what I'm going to show you today is basically about two different kind of material systems. One is highly porous, highly nanoporous palladium systems, and another is, as I told you, zinc oxide systems. Okay. So look at the way that we have fabricated so that we have good high density nanostructuring. The process that we have developed for zinc oxide is in fact a patented process. It is very novel because we use just wet chemistry to develop one dimensional structures, beautiful nano jungles or nano trees. You know, you will have a look at all those aspects. And we don't use any expensive methods like PLD or any other deposition techniques. Okay. And then finally, obviously, the application part of it. So just a brief, it's a tech workshop, so I must do my due diligence in terms of some basics. So what are nanostructures or nanosystems? So as I think all of us recall that at least one dimension should be in the nanometer range. Okay, and there are many different classifications based on this aspect of dimensions. And one of the simplest classification is that there can be 0D or zero dimensional nanostructures, which basically means that the nanostructure has all the dimensions in the nanometer range. We are talking about nanoparticles, you know, we're talking about quantum dots, maybe spherical drops of oil, micelles. So these, all the dimensions are at the nanoscale. So that's called zero dimensional nanostructure. Okay, so the terminology is a little different than what you intuitively think nanostructures to be. Then you have one dimensional, where one of the dimensions of these nanostructures is outside the nanometer range, and we are talking about tall structures like, let's say, nanorods, you know, nanopipes or nanotubes. So you have one dimension which is in the nanometer range. What would be the dimension? The radius would be that dimension. And you know, the tallness of it makes the other dimension go to the outside nanometer range. There could be several microns over which such dimensions would exist, and so we call it 1D nanostructure. We have two dimensional, which means that you are talking now about coatings, thin films. So you have at least the width and the breadth, or let's say the depth, which are in the nanometer range. And the remaining, you know, one of the dimensions could be in the outside nanometer range. And then we have this so-called three-dimensional, which are actually all the three dimensions are outside the nanometer range. We really cannot call them nanomaterials, but still we do classify some of the unique property-based, you know, classifications, and that's why this term three-dimensional nanostructures. So you have bulk materials, you know, layer by layer, self-assembled monolayers. All these different aspects get coupled up into three-dimensional. Maybe the unit cell that you could consider, or the unit building block, could be again falling into the 0, 1 and 2D case. But there are many which makes this unit block, you know, although they are property-wise same, but the third dimension makes it into a three-dimensional nanostructure. So having said that, let's look into what are some of the unique properties and unique behavior that such nanostructures can you know, bring in. And so one of the things that always automatically comes is novel performance. And you know, some of the performance is really exotic in nature. I mean, for example, there may be a 1,000-fold increase in the dielectric property by introducing some nanospheres in a small thin film. Okay, The manosphere may have a different property, dielectric property, than overall the film's dielectric constant. Or something like enhancement in the optical signal. You know, you are all aware of quantum dots. So there is basically a case where because of more, I would say, discretization in the orbital, suddenly the Jablonski's diagram and all that, it happens over a long range of time as well as a very, very sharp frequency. So these are some unique aspects which may not be available in bulk materials, and that is why it's very important to study the nano. And there are many such areas, you know, which prop up. So you have nanostructured materials and their roles of surfaces and interfaces. You have performance improvement, and if you look at applications, there are a variety of applications: sensing gases, biological entities, photonics, catalysis, semiconducting processing, semiconductor processing, all these different ranges where the nano word is spanned across and the nanostructures are abundantly present. So in general, manipulation of probably the nanometer size, which makes these materials amenable to the general good of humanity, we can say, and that's why it's important to study these nanomaterials. So what I have today for you is, again, as I told you, four different topics I will be looking into. One of them is the development of nanoporous palladium for sensitive detection of hydrogen. And this I will present in terms of some research which has been done in the lab. You will see the lab towards the afternoon, maybe after the next speaker. You could see how some of these things are fabricated. Okay. Then there is again another dense ZNO nanobundle growth using nanoporous silica template, and that is also again for detection of a gas. Then also the use of such bundles towards photocatalysis. This is something that I would like to really focus for the next few years, because we recently had a big project from water technology for doing remediation of industrial water, and I'll give you a case analysis here, or maybe some kind of maybe why we need this kind of technology as a next generation for doing industrial water processing. And then of course a small medical side of the story, where we developed this HAP ZNO composites, particularly for dental fillers and dental implants. So with this, let's talk about nature at nanoscale. These are some beautiful images which have been developed by one of my students, Dr. Ankur Gupta, who is right now in IIT Bhuvaneshwar. And you know, you can see that although there is a good parity in the structures, but what is different is the scale here. For example, this is a 1 centimeter scale in a cardoon flower, which is abundantly available in nature. This is actually a 1 micron scale, a similar kind of a structure, which is available only at this scale, which is done by zinc oxide. You have nano bamboos, okay? This is nano flowers. You have nano plates, and these all materials are developed in our lab here, and SEM images taken, okay? And you have to also introduce high resolution techniques for studying of these things, because these are visible, these are really beyond the visible range, okay? So therefore you have to really get a lot of, you know, maybe high resolution imaging in order to even see or look at some of these things. So having said that, let's talk about how these nanomaterials are typically synthesized. So one of the approaches that the nanomaterials are really laid out is called the top-down approach. Okay, so you are breaking down an overall higher structure or a higher size into smaller and smaller. Okay, so that is how you do. For example, ball milling, let's say you have a bunch of different crystals and you are doing ball milling there for a long time. So what you'll have is a powder, okay, and beyond the powder you'll have, again, more energy you pack in, the more is the, you know, probably the cracks at the plane, you know, crystal planes, because of which there are smaller and smaller units which are coming out. So that's a way of doing, you can say, from bulk to nano, right? So top down, that means dimension very high to dimension very low. So these are some of the mechanisms which are normally used for top down. Okay, you can have lithography, we can have particularly different forms of lithography. You have a photolithography, you have a e-beam lithography, you know, you have sort of x-ray lithography. Just changing the source to various energies could allow you to go to different resolution levels. Okay, so that way you have different techniques which are top down. And you know, you can see what we mean here from bulk material to quantum dots, how we are going down the size scale. And there is this side of the story which is actually the bottom up approach, which means that we build up, you know, atom by atom, molecule by molecule. There's a lot of learning, by the way, we can have from nature to incorporate such structures. For example, look at the DNA, okay, deoxyribonucleic acid. What is DNA? Basically, it's a set of sugar phosphate backbones, and you have a lot of bases which pair up, and it is a double helical kind of a structure. Anybody has an idea what would be the diameter of that helix of one molecule of DNA? So it's about 2 to 3 nanometers, 20-30 angstrom. So diameter of a helix of one molecule of a DNA is 20-30 angstrom. It could be several centimeters long. In fact, if I look at the chromosomal DNA, if I take chromosome of the human beings and spread it around from one end to another, it will be 6 centimeters long. Okay, and that gets packaged into a small 1 micron cube volume, which is the volume of a nucleus. So you can think of the packing density that mother incorporates, and we are far, far below, you know, what the mother nature can do really. So these are some inspirational experiences, some learning experiences, which allows this concept of so-called bottom-up technology. Okay, so you start with single atoms, you start with single molecules, you make maybe energy principles and try assembling these things in a manner so that you have higher and higher from smaller and smaller. Okay, so you're going atoms to upward, to complex systems. In fact, if I look at biology, the way it has evolved, single atoms packaged towards molecules, molecules packaged towards cells. A bacterial cell is about close to tens of microns, about 2-3 microns, you know, in that size scale. A mammalian cell is about 20 microns, more than that in diameter. So when I am talking about this from smallest to the biggest, really the inspiration comes from the way nature does it, okay? And we use those strategies and try to play around in the 100 nanometers minus, or maybe nowadays the strategy is mostly 10 nanometers minus, where we try to fabricate, synthesize some of these structures. So having given this sort of motivation to work on, the first topic that I would like to discuss is some research which is involved, because we were doing a project for an agency called NPMAS, okay, where we wanted to detect gases with trace concentration. Okay, so there is an automotive platform where some automotive sensors were being planned. By, the previous talker, I mean the speaker, was about probably introduced automotive sensors, right?
Yes.
As far as I, but you know, the kind of effort that is needed to do the reliability or the level of surety with which we can make a sensor, particularly using nano roots or micro roots, that reliability level of the industry is very poor. Okay, there are hardly any industries where MEMS based sensors or something, and people are really trying very hard to bring that inside. Okay, they may say, but then at the end of the day, the story emerges that you know, if you have a macroscopic view of the problem, it becomes a little better, but the resolution loss is there, because there are certain areas where resolution is really needed. Like for example, let's say you're talking about a airbag actuator, where the criticality is about what is going to be the deceleration, okay, at a certain, so that if you hit that cutoff rate, automatically the ballooning would happen and the balloon would grow. Okay, so there, the inertial component of the mass of the sensing element itself is a big problem. Okay, and the reliability level goes down when you talk about these smaller and smaller things. Okay, so our strategy was to develop a sensor which would have a reasonably good response, and particularly when we talk about gas sensing, it is about the change of properties because of gas adsorption and the change back about gas desorption. Okay, something like that. So there, the nano route proved to be really helpful, as I will show you. So this is a porous palladium film. Okay, so these are highly porous. This scale is, I think, close to about, it's about 100 nanometers, I think, that is how this scale is, and these pores are probably close to a few tens of nanometers, okay, maybe 30 nanometers plus. And how we developed it and how we characterized it, I would like to give you some feeling about this. So let's start understanding the sensors area a little more. What is a sensor? What it does? Okay, So sensor is something which senses, right? Senses what? Sense can be an light, sense there can be physical systems which can be sensed, there can be chemical systems, there can be biological systems, okay. And so therefore, you can actually describe a sensor as a device that detects or measures any physical, chemical or biological property or entity and records, indicates or responds to it. So this is the sort of, you know, Wikipedia definition of what a sensor is. So as I told you that depending on what is the quantity we are measuring, there could be physical quantities, like let's say when we talk about pressure, we talk about temperature, distance, these are all physical quantities, and so we are sensing sort of physical properties. And then there are chemical sensors which basically would try to sense chemicals, and they transform this chemical information into some useful signals. And the process of this transformation is essentially involving many stages. One of them is called the recognition stage, okay, and another is called the transduction stage. And what we mean by that is that, let's say when we are talking about chemical, we are detecting arsenic in water. So there are several such ions which are competing ions, and I have to take the arsenic over those ions. Okay, so when we are recognizing a chemical, you have to do it very specifically, and for that you need to recognize that particular target that I have targeted for the detection over the other targets. Similarly, glucose in blood. Okay, and so therefore there has to be some element which should bond, do something, physically absorb to that ion of interest or that molecule of interest over the other ions. That is one step which is called recognition. And the other step is that once you have done that, then the job is, because you don't see an ion, so you have to make a visible sensing in terms of another signal. So that another signal could be, let's say for example, an optical signal, or let's say for example an electrochemical signal. We have glucose in blood, and there is this very famous enzyme called glucose oxidase, which actually catalyzes glucose into gluconic acid and H2O2, and it just generally raises the pH of the medium. So if I have a hydrogen ion detector there, I should be able to say that first of all we have immobilized the glucose, because the GOD is only catalyzing the glucose to generate a high increase in pH, and second is that the pH electrode sensing that hydrogen. So what is it converting into? The chemical signal into an electrical signal. So this process is known as transduction. Okay, so detect something, first of all recognize something, and once you have recognized, start detecting it by changing the chemical information into something which is a machine readable signal. Could be electrical, could be optical, could be mass based, could be temperature based, you know, and so variety of these processes would come in. So these are the two important steps for any sensing design: recognition element, transduction. And obviously after these things are done, then you have a signal output, and the signal output, you know, somehow can be able to give you a sense of what is it that you are detecting and how much of it is that you are detecting, right? So these are what important things about sensor design. Particularly for sensing, there are certain parameters that are important for you know, classifying the sensing to be accurately done, okay, and sensing to be good versus bad. So one of them is the response time, which is the time taken to reach 90% of the sensitivity level, okay. And in case of gases particularly, when we talk about, let's say, palladium based sensing or zinc based sensing, zinc oxide based sensing, we are indicating an electrical property change. So we are indicating a change in the resistance of the material. Okay. So here we are indicating particularly, because just as, you know, this is in context of the gas sensor, that is why I would like to use the word resistance here, but sensitivity generally could be any parameter that you are sensing. So you can generalize like that. But sensitivity means a percentage change of resistance. So for example, there is a film which has resistance R, and you have subjected it to some gaseous environment because of which the resistance has changed to R plus delta R. So we are talking really about delta R by R as a percentage. Okay, so that's called sensitivity. Now, what is in your mind or intuitively, what as an engineer you will think when you want to design a system that your sensitivity should be as high as possible, because your delta R by R should be something where, you know, a variety of, let's say for example, you have a small trace gas and a bigger gas, okay, the range of resistance variation should be such that you should be able to detect all the different concentrations associated with it, okay. So it's like a coupling between the gas and the sensing element. So that is sensitivity. Then you obviously have recovery time, and this is more so for the gas sensing. that supposing you are detecting hydrogen or you are detecting some other gas, let's say even LPG, and the sensing element is there and it has changed in its resistance, etc. Now the sensing element has been shifted to another area where there is a low concentration of hydrogen or low LPG. So it should be able to go back, or the resistance should be able to go back to the baseline level, okay? And it doesn't happen like that. I mean, there is always a shift in the baseline, as you will see, as I'll show you some real trends that we have, that there is some change in the material property state as you go from one level to the other level. So therefore, this property of recovery time is very, very important, okay, as far as a sensor goes, because obviously if you are not able to recondition the sensor back to do the next measurement, there is going to be a time delay. And unfortunately, all these systems, automotive systems, they don't wait for so long for you to give your signal, you know. So therefore, the sensor system has to be able to recondition very, very quickly. It's called recovery, okay. And then obviously reproducibility is very important, but it's very poor. Let me be very frank with you, when we are discussing all this, I will just tell you that nano systems or nanometric systems, if you look at large scale applicability, it has really not come to that stage where I can deploy them in millions of numbers, okay. So, but then we people are trying to play around, so with the recovery, the sensitivity, these issues much more. So we started with hydrogen, and one of the reasons why hydrogen is important, as we all of us know, you know, the future generation cars, etc., the fuel cell based, they all are dependent on hydrogen, right? And then you have many applications. You have the whole industrial applications where hydrogen is used as a input gas. You have space exploration, nuclear power plants, all these different applications where hydrogen can be used. But there is a problem in hydrogen, and the problem is this factor here, okay, the flammable range. If you look at the lower side of the flammable range, okay, and this is also known as the lower explosion limit, it is about 4% in air. That means you know, it just inflames, okay, and therefore trace detection particularly in these applications becomes a very important issue, a very challenging issue. There were some friends from SSE that we were talking about earlier, and they deploy these inflatable antenna systems, okay, in space. And there the goal is that how can I work in about less than 1000 ppm level of let's say a particular gas, so that I should be able to reproducibly say that such gas leakages are not there, okay. Hydrogen that way is a very risky gas because of its low limit of explosion, and so we want to just detect something in a range where we can actually be able to cope up with detection of 4% hydrogen. Also, it is colorless, tasteless, odorless, so they cannot be detected by any human senses, and so therefore this need necessitates a selective fast speed and sensitive sensor technology for detection of hydrogen. So what are porous materials? So as per the IUPAC convention or norms, the porous materials, or particularly the nano porous materials terms, have been used to refer to materials which have diameters between 1 and 100 nanometers. There can be pores which are closed pores, as can be seen here, and there can be pores which are connected pores, as you can see here. So these are called open pore structures. I hope you realize what I am looking at here. It's a section of the particular element or particular film. So you have closed pores and you have open pores. And if you wanted to play around with gas or gases, a diffusivity, which is a very important term here, because remember that when the is coming to change the resistance properties of the material, it as well needs to diffuse out when the percentage hydrogen should change, okay. So the porous, in a way, is the solution to some extent, you know, and you will see that the time scales that we are using are in seconds, okay, in this particular case. So that way we have really reduced the time scale to almost 24 seconds, the recovery, etc., and that's actually by in the nano world a big development. I don't know, I mean, the normal gas sensors, what is going to be the response time like, okay, but response time is very, very much affected as far as nano world goes. So what are the properties? So you have high surface to volume ratio, being nanoporous. You have excellent mechanical properties, fluid permeability, high adsorption capacity, and again good stability and durability while in use. So that's how nanoporous materials can be known as. And the term porosity can be looked at as the fraction of pore volume to the total volume. So you have some pores here. So, you know, what is the total amount of pore volume per unit, the total volume of this film is what the porosity is going to be. So, how is hydrogen detected, or what are the kind of mechanisms that hydrogen has been conventionally detected? There are many ways of looking at hydrogen. You have catalytic sensors where, you know, there is a heat release when hydrogen and oxygen reacts together. So with this heat release, you can sense what is the percentage hydrogen. There are thermal conductivity sensors here. You can see there is a hydrogen chamber and there is a normal air chamber. There is a difference in the thermal conductivity with which you could sense how much hydrogen over the air. You know, there are electrochemical sensors where there is some kind of a reaction which is with hydrogen gas being bubbled. Remember the standard hydrogen electrode that all of you at one point of time, I'm sure all of us have done. So there is a hydrogen gas bubbling which is going there, which changes the molar, or which keeps the molar ratio within certain you know, aspect. And then there is a, some 4.8 or some volt which is generated, which is actually the standard of the electrochemistry. So all measurements are with respect to the standard hydrogen electrode. But what is that? It is a hydrogen sensor. You know, I mean, there is gas being bubbled at a certain percentage and the molarity being maintained, because of which there is a voltage which is there at the output. Okay. So such things are known as, again, electrochemical sensors. There are mechanical sensors, particularly palladium, which adsorbs the gas and changes from its alpha to beta state. It expands, you know, and there is a change in the mass because of that. And because of that mass, if I were to put this on a small cantilever, then the way that the cantilever is vibrated, that signal would change because of the mass effect. Okay, and so if that mass can be somehow detected, we could say how much hydrogen has been adsorbed by that particular material. And then there are resistance-based sensors. So this is what our domain of work is. We mostly work in this semiconductor metal oxides and metallic resistance sensors. So here the conductivity changes by virtue of adsorption of the hydrogen in one case, and in zinc oxide case it is basically an electron release which happens because there is a defect state induced onto the metallic semiconductor, and this electron release changes the band gap because of that. I will come into the details when we show you the sensing elements and the way they work actually. Then there are work function based sensors. So many different techniques are already available, and I have chosen this resistance based sensor more so because it's relatively easier to operate. And you know, one issue that we always think when we plan sensor design is that can it be machine readable? Okay, and can it have as less as possible of you know, interfaces? For example, electrochemical, there is always an interface between a solid electrode and an electrolyte. Okay, and that creates a huge problem in the sensitivity, etc. I mean, if you go a little bit detail and look at the ion transport mechanism around a solid liquid interface, it is a huge problem as far as electrochemical sensing works out. But still in the bio world, probably electrochemical sensing is the best available so far and the most, you know, but then there is no other alternative. That's the reason why. Okay, but otherwise, resistance based sensor is very easy because you could actually simply do a V equal to IR, and you could actually do just a current variation, you know, so that you could map the resistance for a fixed voltage condition. So it's a very simplistic design with which you could draw out, and one of the reasons why also we also went for the resistance based sensing. So how we do the fabrication of this porous palladium? Okay, you saw the porous film earlier. So here it is a two-phase sputtering process that we are incorporating. And for those of you probably who are not aware of what is the sputtering process, okay, so the way that it happens is that you have a argon plasma, okay, and there are certain target metals which are kept in that plasma. And you know, you are having a bias voltage to one of the electrodes of the plasma where there is a substrate which is kept. Okay, so the argon plasma per se goes and strikes into such metallic targets and pulls out the metal vapor. Okay, and the metal vapor is again transported by the argon plasma onto the biased substrate. Okay, so it's a sort of an impinged deposition, okay, of whatever metal vapor phase is around in that plasma. And that's how sputtering is done. We have a sputtering chamber, you will see that when you go to the lab. Okay, we have a three-gun source here. Without breaking open the vacuum, you could do three layers, at least three layers of metals, one over the other, and that's how thin films are normally deposited actually. So here what we do is that we have a substrate which is having a set of electrodes again done through lithography and lift-off process, and I'm not going into the details of all these processes, okay. We wanted to just share the results and how it goes, but it's an interdigitated electrode. You can see, you can probably think of that, you know, something like where you have a capacitative kind of a situation, you know, there are parallel thin films which are printed, and this whole sensing element is on the top of such an interdigitated electrode. So what you do, you deposit titanium, and this is an adhesion layer, and then you deposit palladium layer, and then you basically have two guns operating together so that the aluminum and the palladium phase, so we are using two different metals here in formulating an alloy, okay. So there is a palladium source, there is an aluminum source, and we are depositing an alloy vapor on the top of this particular material or the silicon substrate. So if you control the plasma properties, you could actually typically end up having more palladium or more aluminum, okay. And the strategy that we are using here is that we etch away the aluminum later on. Okay, so basically once the aluminum is deposited, and I say it is a film which is 40% palladium and 60% aluminum, and then there is another film which is 80% palladium and 20% aluminum, which will be more porous. The 40% palladium will be more porous because we are taking off the aluminum phase and it is in a vapor phase. So that is the strategy we are using here to get porosity. It's not easy to find. It took about probably about more than a year plus to get to a level where we could have this metal vapor being captured, and we could do the right kind of etching there so that the aluminum phase could be slowly taken away. So once we do that, you have a film which is of this ALX PD1-X type, okay, and X is typically in our case varied between 0.5 to 0.8, and you know, the films are of about 500 nanometers thickness, and we dealloy the aluminum using a very common method. It's a combination of phosphoric acid, nitric acid, and acetic acid, and each of them play their own individual roles. The HNO3 basically is responsible for the aluminum to alumina conversion. So this converts into Al2O3 because of the HNO3, and the phosphoric acid is involved in dissolving of the alumina. So basically whatever aluminum is being left in the whole film first gets converted into Al2O3, and then it's a slow dissolution process because there is an acetic acid which interferes with the rate at which the dissolution is happening, because of which there is high porosity generated. Okay, so these are some of the governing chemical equations without going into the details of it. But you can see that there is a case here that all the aluminum phase would go away and the palladium phase would stay on the top of the chip, the microchip. So these are some EDAX spectroscopy results which shows that the aluminum peak is gone here. So this is pre-etching, this is post-etching. So you can see that the aluminum is kind of going away, okay. And we can also see with the electron dispersive spectroscopy that the aluminum has been taken off, and porosity at the behest of aluminum getting removed is what we conclude using this particular method. This is our gas dynamic gas analyzer which we have in our lab. Maybe if time permits, we'll show you how we do these measurements. So it is basically a system where, you know, this is that small chip that we are talking about where there are electrodes and on the top of it there is a film, and these are the two contacts which will simply do the V equal to IR analysis and nothing else, okay. But this whole process is carried in a controlled condition, so obviously you have to generate a condition which talks about 4% is about 40,000 ppm. Calculate it back, you'll try to probably get, okay. So we are talking about 1000 ppm minus, and so that would be you know, in the range. So you have to be really particular about how much hydrogen you are loading in the chamber. So there is going to be a carrier gas and there is going to be hydrogen. In our case, our carrier gas is argon. And how do we control that? We have mass flow controllers for operating at that level where you can have a trace amount of injection of the hydrogen, and then you inject and de-inject so that the hydrogen goes up and comes down, okay, something like that. And you have a cyclic response this way. The other issue is that these are all high temperature processes. Unfortunately, in the gas sensing world, now there is a lot of utility or the study in the graphene area, but unless graphene evolved, all the processes were done at high temperature. So typically our processes are 180 degrees Celsius. Zinc oxide is even higher. 350 degrees Celsius. So that is a big problem why you cannot integrate into sensing system also, because maintaining that high temperature becomes a big problem. So there are some micro hot plates and some other technologies which have evolved where you could have a small inertial mass heated to that zero to a room temperature to 350 degrees by a 1 watt power or 2 watts power. In fact, there is a nano sniff technologies in Bombay who has such a system they have developed. But there also they cannot go beyond 150 degrees, at least what I talk to the CEO very often there, Nitin Kale. So 150 degree plus becomes a big challenge there, okay, because obviously there is a heat loss as well. You have to remember, I'm sure some of you are mechanical engineers, that a surface area is also more at that scale. So the heat loss becomes tremendous. And so the equilibrium temperature reaching 150 plus, you know, becomes a big issue in that particular case. Okay, so here is such a chamber, test sample, electrode, and then the hydrogen filled atmosphere. These are some results that I like to share with this particular technology. So we have a case where the hydrogen is switched on, and now we are measuring the sensitivity, which is again delta R by R as a percentage. So we are going all the way to, let's say, some particular value, maybe some you know, percentage. It's I think close to 50% maybe. Okay, and then when the hydrogen is switched off, it comes down again, switch on, switch off. So this is a sort of a dynamic response analyzer, you could say, that you keep on changing the hydrogen concentration and you can keep on getting the results. So we made a lot of measurements because obviously you have to do the reproducibility. These are all acquired data. This is nothing which is related to manual data acquisition or something. Okay, and what we found out is the following. Our conclusion is that our best sensitivities are at 180 degrees Celsius. And you know, if I looked at gas constants, you could go all the way to almost about 100 ppm level, okay? I think 150, that is what it says, 150 ppm level, which is this particular curve here, okay, where there is still some recordable change in resistance, close to about 38%. I have a summary of all this here. So you can see that the maximum sensitivity is achieved at 180 degrees Celsius temperature. And this is our response and recovery time. So we are operating one cycle within probably 33 seconds. Okay, so this is a very, very small number in terms of sensing response. And believe me or not, the people who are working in sensor research will realize that getting in the second range itself is a big challenge for any nano device which is sensing actually. And so we have achieved that because of the porosity, etc., that is there. So we envision that this, because of easy diffusivity of the gases, and maybe the adsorption desorption phenomena is quickly done because of that, because of the many nanopores. We also did something for comparison of sensitivity. So with the CO2 in the system at 600 and 300 ppm, we see how our films are more sensitive. So CO2 is really not, it's a different process altogether. So our films are quite sensitive, as we can see here, to that 600 ppm or 300 ppm. So also, you know, there are other results that I have not included, but in the presence of methane, nitrogen also, we have tried to investigate the sensitivity. And this appears to be reasonably good film, which gives you replicable values or modes of sensing hydrogen gas. So that is how I talk about the first set of nanostructures, that is nanoporous palladium. So the take home message here is 180 degrees is the temperature typically where we are looking at, 80% is the sensitivity, and it's probably 34 seconds. So some of these values are probably of importance as far as the sensing design goes into. And obviously the integrability and how you can heat up. So this whole thing is done in situ, so heating up is not a problem. But heating up in a small chip scale becomes a huge problem. So we had a initiative with Siri Pilani and some other microfabrication organizations. So they are in the process of developing that micro scale hot plate. As I told you, NanoSniff has already developed it. And we are trying to integrate the film to that hot plate and trying to do some IV responses to see how sensitivity can, or how quick this can be deployed. Okay, but it's a long way from deployment, I would say. So the second aspect that I would like to discuss here is this another work that we have in nanostructures, because I just thought that I'll give something in the nano as ma'am had requested. So that is why I pulled together all the work that I could think of on our group, which is in the nano area. And so I would like to give that instance. So here is the zinc oxide system. So it's a semiconducting metal oxide, okay? And as you know that it is primarily a n-type material, but how we do the structuring or nanostructuring is a very novel step here, because that's where we had the patent, that how we could grow one-dimensional nanostructures using just wet chemistry methods. Okay, and here is what we do. So we use a porous bed here, which is made up of polymers. So there are two different phases. One is small nanoparticles of this polymethyl silsesquioxane. Okay, this is called PMSSQ, and you know, they formulate a porous network. That is the advantage that this particular polymer has. Actually, the particles which are present, they get surface bonds developed. If you can if you can take them across variety of temperature and dissolution steps, actually. Then there is PPG, which is an assembler. So this would be helping. It's like a surfactant which will be helping to build up pores where you could place these particles. And this is a solvent, really, polyglycol methyl ether acetate. You know, and I'm not asking you to learn up all this chemistry. I just wanted to tell you that what is the process of formulation. That's why I mentioned all these three things. Okay. So what happens here is the following: that you have a film which you obviously, because there is a dissolution agent, there is a dissolving agent. So you have a liquid now with these particles dissolved and the surfactant molecule which is dissolved. And I think all of us are probably, at least some of us are aware that how the surfactant works. So there is a micelle being created, and you know, it separates the particles and it assembles the particle in a particular manner. Okay, so there is this whole surfactant chemistry. So basically it works on nothing but hydrophilic and hydrophobic chemistry. Okay, and so you can have micelles, you could have cylindrical micelles, spherical micelles, all sort of micelles. Micelles means an arranged, a sort of orderly manner in solution state. Okay, that is what we are talking about here. So having said that, now what we do is we take a thin film, spin it, and then you know, we basically let it go through a certain thermal cycle. And what happens through this thermal cycle is that the PPG is a much more volatile product than the PMSSQ, and it evaporates. Okay, and as the PPG evaporates, there is some kind of a chemistry which we also know as sol-gel chemistry between the PMSSQ, and it formulates a network of balls, you can say. And if these balls are all, let's say, 30 nanometers or 20 nanometers, so the gaps in between them would be pores. Okay, so that's how you formulate highly porous films with a pretty low refractive index. Okay, so we call these films air-like, because their refractive index is in the range of 1.09 or something like that. So how do you know that they are porous? So these are some very nice cross-sectional images, you know, SEM images, where we show how porous these films are. This is the top view, this is the side view, and you can see that there are porous pores present all round the material. It's not really only a surface effect, but towards the depth also, there is a huge amount of pore formation. And further, if we do some characterization here, you know, so first characterization is to see what is going to be the refractive index. Okay, and as you can see here, that the refractive index varies as a function of depth. Okay, so towards the surface, the refractive index is low, but as you go above, by what is the refractive index of air? I'm just needless to ask this question. Sorry, I get into that state that I'm teaching students. So one, right? So we are going one plus. And 1.098, okay, so it's very close to one, so it's air-like. Okay, so think about the utility of such a film. If I were to put water on the top of this, whose refractive index is 1.33, it could be a waveguide. Okay, so you could actually have total internal reflection at the surface. In fact, we have been exploring this for developing something called an epifluorescence microscope on a chip with some of these films, where we can actually record fluorescence signals, etc. But here, what I meant to say is that this refractive index shows two things. One is that the PPG has evaporated and it has created small pores, and further there is a pore gradient. So there is a pore density which is probably higher towards the top, but as we go down the depth, and you can do a depth profile using an ellipsometer. It's a very commonly available technique for assessment of refractive index. Of course, it's not a direct report, but through a modeling that you reported. You have many factors plugged in, like surface roughness, etc. But you could actually go to various levels, okay, with a resolution of hundreds of nanometers. Yahan pe kya hai? 0 to 800 nanometers. And at every level, we are seeing what is the refractive index. Okay, so it's called a gradient film. These things exist, more or less. But you go from 1.098 all the way to 1.112. And one of the reasons why that is so is that probably, you know, towards the top, we feel that the evaporation is more, okay, because obviously it is closer to the atmosphere. And also the fact that PPG actually melts and then vaporizes, okay. So when it melts by gravity action, what will happen is that it will start coming down, okay. So even though this is the highest point of the temperature on the lower side, the maximum pores would form on the upper side. So that is our logic, which has been internationally accepted, and so therefore there is a gradient film that we have made. Now my goal with you is not to mention how we fabricated this film, but how to fabricate the zinc oxide structures, okay. So we take the same strategy and we basically develop particles which are zinc oxide particles, okay, nanoparticles, and there is a standard technique for this. It's very well known that how zinc oxide can be grown, okay. So there are certain precursor solutions that you are using here, and with those precursors, mixing them together, you can have small particles, okay. So this SEM image in fact here shows such particles. So there are these small particles which are here. So we can scrape off this particle, okay, and we can mix it in the solution which we had made earlier with the PPG, the PMSSQ and the PGMEN. And when we will do the evaporation, what happens is that the particles, the zinc oxide particles, which has a higher evaporation point, I mean it is not so volatile as PPG is, they will get trapped into those pores, okay. So you have a case where you have a porous template which has the trapping of the zinc oxide at the various levels, okay, between the porous template. In fact, not only getting trapped, but very interestingly what we find out through this absorbance plot, the FTIR's plot, that you have a formulation of a small bond through the Sol-Gel chemistry process between the SiO that is available on a PMSSQ particle, okay, and the zinc. So it is not only trapped, but it is bonded, okay. So we have very good illustration here where we can record that the zinc oxide is at various levels of those pores and they are also further bonded in their place. So there cannot be any diffusion based movement anymore of the zinc oxide particles. So once we have done that, obviously we use the standard vapor capture process. So we have another precursor set and typically we take this film upside down and put it over that solution and let it thermally evaporate. So wherever there is a zinc oxide center, you know, it leads to the process of one dimensional growth, okay. It's a very famous analysis that how it will happen in one dimension. There is a planar analysis. Maybe some point of time later I will show you that how it happens. But you can see there are different structures now which are one dimensional. There are these nano rods. There are these woodsite crystals, hexagonal crystals all coming out. There are these small tubular kind of crystals. And what we are doing from the rods is that we are just changing the precursor ratios, you know. So we are starving the process. So we are having less zinc oxide here. So we can have these tubular kind of structures which are there. And by the by, we saw a very interesting phenomena in this tubular structure. They call that nanotechnology has so unique phenomena that there is a change in the majority carriers, okay. So the N-type zinc oxide at a certain temperature becomes suddenly a P-type zinc oxide, because the way that the oxygen defect management takes place on the top of the surface of such zinc oxide structures. So you know, the other advantage that our films have is that these are carpeted, so you can see that wherever there is a template, there is going to be zinc oxide, okay. So you have these carpets, right. So that is the advantage. So as a microfabrication engineer, I myself will think of it in this manner, that I can pattern it. That is the first thought that it comes to me, that I can pattern such small strips without growing zinc oxide. And you know, it is all one dimensional standing up structures, okay. And this is the kind of integration density. You can see they're like small nano forests, nano jungles, those kind of things standing up. So having said that, now these are some other images that I would like to share, you know, how these zinc oxides are grown and all. There is a very famous way that resistance change would happen in the presence of hydrogen. So what is that there are a lot of these oxygen adsorbates, okay, which are called oxygen defects, so O minus typically. And if there is hydrogen or some other reducing element in the or gas in the chamber, then there is a electron release here. Mind you, the release means that the release goes back into the crystal, okay. So the oxygen adsorbate goes away and the electron is given back into the zinc oxide, and because of that the carrier concentration improves. Okay, so there will be a change in the resistivity because of this electron release. Okay, so that is the basic mechanism in which hydrogen would be sensed with such zinc oxide structures. So we did some analysis again. Now, as I already shared with you that this all these sort of happen at a much more higher temperature. So you have the range from 250 to 350 degrees, and you can see here that the normalized resistance falls down. Obviously, electron release would mean that the resistance will go down, right? The conductivity will improve. So you are taking the conductivity here all the way to some level here, and then you know you have constancy where the hydrogen is still there in the chamber, and when the hydrogen is switched off, it goes higher like this. So we did all sort of analysis with woodside crystals, with one dimensional nano rods, and with this sort of one dimensional nano tubes, and we figured out that in case of nanotubes, we have a sudden conversion in the the carrier concentration from N type to P type, okay, as a function of temperature. Okay, and this was a recording here which led us to this result. Obviously, in one case you are having decreasing resistivity and suddenly there is an increase in the resistance and none of the other things are changing, so you will probably interpret that there is some change in the carrier concentration. In this case, obviously the carrier is the one which transports all the charges, right? So that is how semiconducting metal oxides are characterized also. So with PL spectra, we could actually see really that there is an increase in the defect state. So between the solid nanorods and the hollow nanorods, suddenly there is an increase in the frequency at 500 nanometers. Okay, and also there is a shift actually, which indicates that there is an increase in the quantum of defects. So probably if we look back into those structures here, right here what I showed, the hollowness of this structure is resultant or is resulting in a huge amount of absorbate based defects on the surface of this structure. That must be the reason why even the PL spectra also shows that. That is how you do. I mean, there is no other way to sort of interpret what is going on except doing all this analysis actually. Okay. So having said that now, so you saw that how zinc oxide also can do very good gas sensing. Okay, but again, the problem here is that here the resistance is in mega ohms, and the earlier what we were talking about was probably just in the ohmic range. So there is some difference in terms of, again, you know, how much can you really get. Okay, we tried many other orientations of this zinc oxide, including one where we would have a composite assembly that we deposit a layer of palladium on the top of these zinc oxide structures and try to see if there is an improvement in the sensitivity. So we are working on that problem. I don't have many answers to it, but the overall there has been an increase in the sensitivity because of this palladium zinc oxide nanostructures as opposed to only the zinc oxide nanostructures. So in conclusion, we developed this novel approach of fabricating high density nanostructures, okay, and then we also used them for investigating the sensing behavior as related to hydrogen. We do have an improvement when we study the palladium zinc oxide over the normal zinc oxide system, okay, in this kind of sensing design. The other thing that we found, because we had this situation where we had a pinned up nanostructure, and this is very interesting, I will just share the story. These are also very good photocatalytic agents. Okay, zinc oxide is a very good photocatalytic agent, and I will just first let you know what is really photocatalysis. Okay, so as we all know that the organic dyes particularly are very hard to remove. Okay, if you look at industrial effluents, for example, I would just talk about the CTEP Jodhpur. There is a combined effluent treatment plant in Jodhpur. In fact, there are CTEPs all around India where they typically look at the industrial water, okay, waste water, and they will do remediation of that water so that they can discharge that back into the natural water resources like rivers, etc. Okay. Now, let me just discuss the case a little bit of the CTEP Jodhpur because we are associated with it. So what happened is that the NIRI, actually initiated this program through which you will have a lot of these CTEPs, you know. So there are many such effluent treatment plants in that region, the Jodhpur region. And there is Sangneri, there is again at Jodhpur, then there is Balasar. So there are many such plants are there. And what they cater to, I will tell you. So there are about close to, particularly the Jodhpur plant, there are close to about 100 plus steel industries, rolling mills, okay, and about close to some 350 textile industries whose effluents get discharged into this CTEP, okay. And typically the steel waste is highly acidic and the textile waste is very alkaline in nature. So they have to do some pH balancing, etc. There are many stages in which they will do water treatment. Okay, one of the stages is called the primary settlement tank. There is a clarifloculation process. There is a process where the sludge is removed. There is desludging. Sludge is further compressed because you want to extract water out of it. Then you go to an aeration mechanism where there is a change in the BOD, COD. I mean, there are microorganisms which will act on the water. And then finally, it goes into a secondary settlement. So there are many steps with which this water would come. But there is a problem. And the problem is that you cannot get rid of the organic dyes and the colors, which is coming from the textile industry. Okay. So such is very abundantly available. Even in groundwater reserves in India today, Panasonic is a company which is really actively looking at this, that, you know, with photocatalysis, can I do organic dye dissociation? Okay, because all these manures and these fertilizers particularly, they're creating a huge problem in the underwater level, I mean the groundwater level. And there's a lot of dissolved organics which goes there, and that has to be somehow remediated. In fact, the Panasonic launched a product called Concept Pro sometime back in 2014, where, and they are very actively looking into photocatalysis driven solutions in India now. Okay, so at household level, can they supply a cheaper system? That is their mandate. So everything is based on this process, or the word that I am again and again using, which is photocatalysis. Okay, what is that word? So the photocatalysis is the following. So basically, you have to use some kind of a mechanism or a catalyst which would create damage to the dyes. Okay. What is the problem? Problem is because of coloration, if you discharge this water back into the river, the natural process of the river based on photosynthesis, that gets affected because now you have a pink water there, or a muddy water there. So the amount of sunlight that can come to grow the sort of algae and the other, you know, biological remediation mechanisms, that gets affected because of it. So the coloration has to be improved so that they can get enough visible solar light. Okay, so that is the major issue. And so how do you do something so that there is remediation? So for example, in our case, we use zinc oxide, but people use a lot of other such semiconductor chemistries like titanium oxide, etc. as well, where you have a whole electron release generation and it affects this organic chain, this dye, it breaks it down and it changes the color completely. This is again rhodium dye, which we have investigated using zinc oxide, where you see the dye concentration here, and then with function of time, if you are exposing it to UV light or solar light, okay, solar I will come later, let's talk about UV light, you are having complete colorless solution. Okay, so from here to here, all this dye breakdown, okay, results in some kind of a change in the absorption spectra. Okay, so this is what our target is. How can we make water colorless? That is the quote unquote, you know, holy grail here actually. Okay, and the problem that comes is that although the colorless water can be obtained using this method, but the organics are still there in the water. Okay, because they are broken. Now their properties, their absorption spectra may change, but they are still there in the water. So you have to have a collection of those organics. So having said this basic background of what is photocatalysis, let us look at how our zinc oxide can do the job. So as you know that these, you know, are carpets now, nano carpets, which can be patterned, etc. So we have developed a filter with this where, let's say we take a sheet of some length and breadth and we do laser machining to drill small holes, okay, and we put this whole growth process of zinc oxide. So now you have holes in the sheet across this membrane or filter membrane, and you have these standalone nanostructures, okay, all around the sheet, and several such filters which are placed in unison through which the water can be recirculated. Okay, so the the one which we proposed, and we are going to now start commissioning this plant, is that you will have a slightly changed zinc oxide structure. As I told you, the hollow structures have a lot of more defect states, okay, and the defect states would change the band gap to the visible spectrum. Okay, so now you have solar based. So we have shown that with what we can do with UV light, we can also do with solar light, okay, and the same diremediation is possible using this hollow structures, pinned up structures of zinc oxide. So having said that, we have a big we have planned for a big big tank unit, which is shallow because you have to have the solar light plugged in, and there are many stages in which this zinc oxide would be put in as immobilized pinned up structures, and we'll pump all this water sample from the pH balance sample, okay, and we will do all this photocatalysis based dye degradation, and it is a matter of probably few hours in which this degradation would happen. Jodhpur, by the way, we chose because it is one of the most it receives solar energy in abundance, okay, and one of those zones where it's considered to be a sun city. I think that's what people tell, it's a sun city, Jodhpur or something. So that's why we chose that. So once this catalysis process happens, we pass this water from the next stage, and there is a company here in IIT which makes these carbon fiber based filters, okay. So so we are in collaboration with them, so we'll have a set of filters associated with this water, so that whatever leftover dye, broken down dye, is there in the water by virtue of our catalysis process will get absorbed in the filter before the water comes out. Okay, the problem with this setup is that if I just wanted to look at their problem, it's a very typical problem. They have a river called Jejuri, into which they are releasing all the sewage and all the industrial effluents. And what has happened is that normally it is not a problem, but during rains, the water kind of overflows. Okay, and it goes and embanks in the embanking regions. It creates huge toxicity actually. So there have been some litigations. There have been PILs, and Supreme Court has given an order. This National Green Tribunal, that you stop the plant, okay, unless you do some kind of photocatalysis, okay, so that the we call it BOD COD level, that should come down to a certain level. So now the proper bacterial action, or the proper whatever the photosynthetic action or process can take place in the river, okay. So we are enabling them in order to get them started. That is the whole idea. But there are not such many photocatalytic industrial level water filters available within the nation, okay, and Korea is doing some work in this area. In our case, probably NIRI has some initiatives that are there, but we are trying to get such a scaled up plant. This is a 10 KLD facility, 10 kiloliters a day facility that we will be installing and commissioning at CTEP very recently. Okay, so having said that background work, I'll just give you some details about the things here. So we can do various kind of defect inducements by heating cooling process, by doing the various starvation, so that you have changed the zinc oxide structures, and these are what the absorption plots are, some of the time scales through which dye is getting remediated. These are again some change in concentration of the dye as a function of these different structures, with defect induced more, so what are the rates at which we are doing the photocatalysis are also very well studied. This is about the reuse of such mechanisms, that can we reuse these many times, okay, and then we also have investigated if we flood these structures with palladium, for example, or let's say for example graphene, what is going to be the utility of it. We have worked on real water samples to find out how the absorption spectra can change, okay, and so there is some inducement, some change in the performance properties, and I don't want to get into the details of this in the interest of time. And so that's what the conclusion is, that we have reached a point where we can actually have these nanostructures do photocatalysis, etc. So I think I'm at the end of the talk, just giving you a few more illustrations, maybe 5 more minutes I will take for how other nanostructures can be applied to various different domains. This is a work we started last year, where we were talking about the very famous GIC, which is called glass ionomeric cement. Okay, so I am sure all of you have gone to a dentist at some point of time. Okay, and cavity filling is a big problem. I had many when I was a child, so I remember the horror and the pain that was associated. So the problem is that, you know, the glass ionomeric cement that they are using, okay, you know, there are two versions of this cement available. One is an antibacterial version. Okay, human mouth, by the by, is full with bacteria. Okay, so probably if any place within the body which has most number of bacteria, you go into your mouth and check, you know, you will get so many microorganisms there. Now, the filler life typically is a function of, so the filling is, you know what is the filling, that you have the GIC incorporated, right, and then there is another layer on the top of it which makes it polished layer, okay, and so you have a tooth-like feeling, and but inside it, inside a cavity, you have this glass ionomeric cement, it's a composite, okay. But the problem is, again, the antibacterial GIC which is available is very costly. And particularly, there are only exporting nations, I mean, the Japan, etc., they sell these kind of GICs. And if you look at the costs, you know, they get elevated because of such antibacterial nature. So we try to do something, some intervention, because zinc oxide is, again, a chemical, although which is very highly cytotoxic, but at a smaller concentration, you can actually have that effect as an antimicrobial effect. Okay. And also, we are talking about a cavity, so we don't have most of the mouth in connect with the cavity. And we had a hard time to do ethical clearance, but finally the dentist, so-called, at a hospital which is in Lucknow, they gave the ethical clearance that you can use inside the filler zinc oxide in a very low concentration. So having said that, we did some studies about you know, various antimicrobial activities, and we prepared our these zinc oxide composite films. Okay, so I will just show you the films first. Let me just go ahead and show. So these are some of the so we have a hydroxyapatite carrier here and a zinc oxide, you know, core here, and then we are incorporating that within the GIC. Okay, so we have n number of things like size controls, etc., which I'm not getting into, but we had a lot of so there are these precursor based chemistries that we are using, so that we have different sizes of control. So zinc oxide in the core, HAP hydroxyapatite on the top, and then it is incorporated inside the conventional GIC. That is the thing that we are working on. And we tried investigating some properties. So we had great antimicrobial properties here, particularly for the mutants stain, which is available inside the human mouth. These are some culture plates which show about the, you know, you can see this zone here of inhibition. So there is a zone of growth inhibition that is happening here. Just wanted to give you some flair of people who are not from the health background or biology background. This is a culture plate. It's a media. You put bacteria and it starts growing. So there are many colonies which are there. Now, if there is some portion where there is either an antibiotic or something which is inhibiting the growth, inhibiting means shortening the growth, it will not grow. So we will have a small well there, you know, and the remaining portion will grow because it is far away and there is no. So this is the standard conventional way to measure in a hospital whether something is antimicrobial or not. A lot of these people who do the bone development, bone growth and all, they use these methods for seeing whether your material is antibacterial. So that's what we tried here. And doing this mutants plating is a very, very, very messy process. So I must acknowledge my colleague here in SGPGI, who was responsible for doing this particular you know, mutant stain. But what we find is that zinc oxide has the efficacy of you know, receding the bacterial growth. And because we have an ethical clearance now, we are very shortly going to try some trials inside the human mouth with the zinc oxide HAP and GIC composite. And you know, in fact, we have initiated a company through this hospital called Deodhan Infratech, which is actually looking into how this can be taken at a product level. Okay, so there are a lot of funding opportunities we are exploring, etc., with BIRAC or some other agencies, where we want to make this technology scale up. That is the idea. So I think I will close on here. I'm sorry I took a little more than, oh, it is already what? 1:10. Okay. I think I'm just about in time, right? So I acknowledge all my students. They have been always with me during this process of all this work. Particular appreciation to all the funding agencies and laboratories who helped a lot. I would like to acknowledge my colleague here, SP Basu Majumdar, who is in material science in IIT Kharagpur. He helped me a lot with initiating me to learn how to do sensing. I was a novice in this area when I started. but by his continuous due diligence with me, I could test on his system and then I could develop a system here for doing gas sensing, etc. So if you have any questions, thank you. Thanks for being patient to listen to my talk. So this is about nano and how nano can be utilized. So that is the summary. Thanks again.